Beatings came first, and then the fondlings and all the palaver came after. He didn't put his penis in, but, well, I was very small, and but everything else went on. I never talked about it. I never mentioned the actual how it was with my father and me. I didn't tell either husband. You know, he was not normal around me, my father. And he'd taken to drink, of course. By the time you and I met each other down in Brighton. And, you know, I mean, the thing with my father and I is that I have such compassion for that man now, because as appallingly wretched as I felt over the situation, and anybody who's suffered sexual abuse knows that a big part of it is that you can't tell anybody, because he said, if I told my mother, it would kill her. And my mother already had been in and out of psychiatric wards. And that also brought its own guilt for me, because I thought, that's my fault, you know. She, you know, that her husband has been unfaithful. She didn't know that with her own child. I mean, one psychiatrist who was a friend of mine, I didn't go to a psychiatrist over it, but I've spoken about it since and I've read voraciously everything, which is what you do, and other people in this position know that too. And he said, the mother always knows, subconsciously, that that is happening with her own girl child and her husband. I never spoke to anybody about it ever, 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 and certainly not to anybody in my family or a teacher or anything or a friend, no, my girlfriends, my boyfriends, husbands, nothing, until my sister's husband was dying and we were looking, he was in hospital. What is it, she said, between you and Daddy? Because she loved my father and they were very close, but not like that. And she said, what was it with that lovely man and you? She said, you were so, you looked at him in a horrible way, Moll. She said, there was absolute antagonism coming from you and he didn't deserve it. She said, what was the trouble there? And that was the moment. So I told her, and she was looking at the sea and her little, she turned to me, a little tear, oh, this heartbreak upsets me now. I think, came dribbling down and she just touched me on the shoulder, and that's all that she could, she didn't have words. But for me, it was the release. I only cry now because of her response, because then she went into a depression, according to her daughter, who's very close to me. I said, I'll talk to my sister about it, that bastard, I thought of him as a bastard then, I don't know, could crucify now my sister's adult life, you know, with guilt. And I said, I'm not having it, Sal. Otherwise, he will have won. And we did talk about it a lot. And I mean, I my tears now are not for me, but that he would have been suffering so much himself, if, you know, from conscience. And Sal said, well, where were we, Mama and I? I said, you were outside. On the stairs leading to the bedroom, and I was in the bedroom, you know, being beaten. And you could, she said, we could hear the screams. It was horrible, Moll. And then there was awful silence. I said, that was the horrible part. But she said he'd locked the door and we couldn't come in, Moll. I said, why would my mother not have gone for a neighbor, a male, to knock down the door? But you didn't do that because, you know, these things, even, you know, beating a child behind, in the bedroom behind the locked door, is meant, you're meant to keep things in the family, aren't you? You're not, then it was, now everybody can talk about it. But that was, for me, the release when I was in my 60s, 66 or something, 67 maybe, it fell away. And I mean, I'd been in therapy. I didn't talk about it in therapy, though one very shrewd man who'd been in the fellowship as well, the fellowship of AA, and he was an academic, and he said, what happened between you and your father? Was there abuse, Molly? And no, I said, I wouldn't have said that. I couldn't do that. That was even like 10 years ago. I couldn't talk about it. But and now we talk about it, Sal and I, you know, and my niece who's a social worker, we talk about it. She said, I don't understand how you can forgive him. Because she said, I see all this and how a man could do that to his own child, or indeed paedophiles with any child. I said, it's not easy for them. That is all that I've given to understand. And if I didn't forgive him, I would be carrying it to my grave. He would have won to my grave. So I've written it all in detail in my in the book that I wrote, you know, that we're giving to Bloomsbury. And indeed, to tell you the truth, the writing of it, which is what's instanced all of this figurative painting, everything has fallen away. And my social life and the wonderful sexual escapade that I had only 8 weeks ago or 9 weeks ago in Las Vegas. So, you know, I mean, I want that book to be published. I don't give a shit, really, whether it's published or not, for money or anything. I've gone beyond all of that, and I've had enough interviews and had enough publicity. I don't need to be, you know, center stage anymore. But I do think that if I'd read that book when I was suffering, it would have helped me immensely to know that there is life after abuse. I had a facelift 17 years ago when, no, 18 years ago now, because I gave up drinking 19 years ago, and I had all that depravity cut away. So what they did, they cut away all of this, they cut away all the bags, you know, because I was out all day and all night. When I mean out all night, I mean all night. I used to smoke about 100 cigarettes a day. By the end, I was only on lager, because that's all. I couldn't manage, certainly couldn't manage the whiskey that I'd started drinking my career was. So that was all written on my face. I've got a photograph of before and after, which was in the Sunday Telegraph, and that shows a before, and people said, that wasn't you. Well, it was me, with no makeup on, of course, and people were used to seeing this rather exquisite mask, and you'll see how clever a painter I am in a minute. Anyway, what they did, they took all this out. He said to me, is there anything you particularly want done? I said, this could do with a little bit of plumping up. This was before the stuff they use now, you know, everybody looking like that. And so he said, well, the body will welcome its own flesh more than a foreign substance put in. So he said, all this stuff here, because it had come now and I had little piggy eyes, and then taking all the stuff, cutting the bags away, he said, I'll sew that into the top lip. And it was only local anaesthetic for that. So I saw him putting that, like a little, you know, filling a sausage roll, and he slipped there. And there, it's gone now, that scar, because he was consummate with it. And then he did liposuction there, because it was all, you know, withered. She could be done again, but I'm not bothered. I wouldn't do it. I didn't do it to look younger. And then he cut in there, and then he pulled it up there. And so he did, what they don't tell you is that when they're cutting into the scalp, that's not in any of the literature, and I didn't know it then, but if I was writing about it now, I would say, where they've cut into the stump, that effectively knocks off all those hair follicles, so it doesn't grow easily again there. And you've got a little kind of funny thing. See where it doesn't grow and where it doesn't grow? But it doesn't matter, because I'm in my hats now, and I think that looks like a design feature myself. My childhood consisted of the strongest influences from chapel and Hollywood, the cinema screen. I was very drawn to an actress called Peggy Ann Garner, because I saw her as when she was playing the child in Of Jane Eyre. She played Jane as a child, and Joan Fontaine played her as an adult. She was around, well, she was playing a sort of 12-year-old then, 11-year-old maybe. Around, but I had first seen her in a film called A Tree Grows in Brooklyn. That was a pivotal film for me in many ways, because the father who she adored was an alcoholic and feckless and unreliable and let down the family all the time, especially in money matters, a gambler. And that really was quite an accurate portrait of my father, though I didn't know it then. What I most identified with that character that she was playing, that she was obsessed with writing. She carried a little notebook around with her everywhere and a pencil, and she licked the pencil and she wrote little notes about everybody that she met. And I thought, what an amazing way to live. And I had a notebook and a pencil, but I was doing drawings in it instead. And I thought I'd best be switching over to doing the writing here now. I then switched my affections. I was seduced by the beauty of Elizabeth Taylor at that early age. And this was around the time, it was Jane Eyre was before she did National Velvet, which wasn't so much my cup of tea really, but everything of Elizabeth Taylor's I've seen since. There is a theory that when you fixate on somebody, a person, and you start to live your life in imitation of them, as I had with Peggy Ann Garner with the writing, you then can start looking like them. And something of that nature must have taken place around the age of 11 and 12 when I started my periods. My body started sprouting little breasts. I was no longer valued for being a very good painter and writer at school. My value seemed to shift to the attention I started getting from the opposite sex. I didn't notice it at first because I was so overjoyed that when my period started and my body started developing, my father no longer pestered me sexually. But now, wherever I walked, because these eyes somehow had become lighter and bigger and the hair of its own accord became darker, and like Elizabeth Taylor's. So by the time I was 13, 14, people were already starting to remark on how like Elizabeth Taylor I looked. And boys started to have crushes on me. I had no interest in them at all because I was a chapel girl and we were still going to chapel in England. We were living in London every Sunday, and God was very close to me then. When I went to art school, obviously I was a virgin. My mother told me, you must never, ever, ever go to a boy's room. If he asks you to go to his room, you must just absolutely say no. Within weeks of being there, practically days, this Lothario, who all of the girls who had been to Rodin or private schools, all fell in love with him, and he was cross, I suppose, between Brad Pitt and touch of Robert Redford, that kind of charm, quite devastating, really, and blue eyes, very English, which, of course, for a racist like me, Welsh, I'd been taught to loathe the English. I ended up going to his room. I didn't know what he was doing, really, but he flung me on the bed, and we used to wear petticoats. It was the 50s then. We had a lot of petticoats and little nipped-in waists, and up went this hand inside my knickers, and there wasn't really any kissing. I mean, that really was what rape, when I think back on it. And it was painful, and I said, don't do that. And I felt moistness there. I didn't know what was happening. And I said, I have to go to the lavatory now. And I had white knickers on, and there was blood on them. Well, my mother did the washing at that time. I was petrified because when I came back, I said, I'm bleeding now. And he said, oh, that will be your periods. But I said, I finished my periods 10 days ago and they only come once a month. And so he said, I did kiss you. Yes, I said. And he had planted a kiss on my mouth before, but fleetingly, and he said lots of girls bleed when they have their first kiss. Oh, right, I said, do they? Okay. And I believed him. I wasn't very worldly, but I left that art school and went down to Brighton, and I did have a couple of steady boyfriends who both had asked me to marry them before you came down. They weren't my fiancés in the way that we were affianced, as it were. It wasn't serious. And nothing sexual took place. I certainly never, ever was in a room with them. He just used to kiss me goodnight on the doorstep. That's as far as I would go. But then I did come to your room, and you did have a bath. Are we allowed to say all this?
Yeah, I mean, why not?
It's part of it. You had a bath, and I thought that was extraordinary. And you called me when you were in the bathroom, and I came, and you were just standing, and the bath water was at your feet, and you had nothing on at all. And I'd never ever seen a male nude ever, because all the nudes that we drew and painted in art school all wore their pouches. But you were the first boy that I'd seen, and I thought you were the most beautiful thing. I really wish that my first instinct was, where is my pencil to draw you? And I never did draw you and haven't ever drawn you. And I really wanted to do a painting. It really blew my breath away, but I was full of trepidation, because then you came out, sauntering out, drying yourself on the towel. It was obviously not the first time you'd been nude in front of a female. And I felt that extremely naive and inept and awful and ugly compared to you. And then I found myself in your bed, in your little bedroom there, just off the seafront, wasn't it, in Brighton. And then, and it was hopeless because I just, well, you said last week, and that shocked me when you said you were frigid. Nobody's ever said to me, well, I haven't been frigid on any other occasion apart from that. So that was vaginismus, and it didn't really occur, did it? Our intercourse couldn't have occurred, and couldn't until I had sex with James Robertson Justice, 30 years older. He knew how to defreeze those muscles. Well, he filled me full of champagne for a start. And that then, my sex life did begin properly. I had been in rooms with men before James. I had been in the beds of very old men, because they didn't seem to want to penetrate and couldn't have done so anyway, because they were, you know, I was in the genial company of impotent men. Men in their 60s, 70s, 80-year-old I slept with as well. All my girlfriends had been saying, why don't you come to this, that and the other party, you know, with us and meet people our age. It's not healthy to be with those old men you were sleeping with, millionaires. And so I started going to parties with them because, you know, I was delirious with grief over my mother, because my mother suddenly became like my child and I knew I would have to take care of her. She'd been in and out of mental homes all our lives, and she's very vulnerable, and that distressed me because now she didn't have a husband there. So I started going to parties. I went to one party and I met, and so she started saying to me, with the death of my husband, we need a man in the family, a good, strong man. Now it's for you to provide that, Moll. Now this is what you've got to look for. Public school, Eton or Harrow, preferably, and Oxford or Cambridge. And if he's done his national service, he's got to have had a commission. Well, I met Michael and he complied, not with Eton and Harrow, but another famous public school. Well, I don't know much about public schools, so I don't know anything about that. But he also said, would you allow me to drive you home? He had everything because he was Oxford all of that, and he'd been an officer in the Irish Guards, and my mother would have liked that. So I let him drive me home, and he said, would you come and stay with me next weekend? So next morning, I got on the phone, and I said, I think I've met him, Mama. So she said, oh, good, has he asked you to marry him yet? And I said, well, I only met him last night. So she said, well, go and stay with him. She said, that sounds good. I went to stay with him, and everything was in place. Sexually, we were very, very compatible. I was with both my husbands. You know, there are some skins which don't quite match your own. You can be in bed with somebody and there can be a clamminess in the skin, whereas his was very smooth skin, like my skin, and we just slid together. And the sex, and we just spent the whole time in bed, really, or else drinking champagne in the pub, you know, with all his friends who I did like very much. So he said, I'm coming to London during the week. I'll be up on Wednesday. He put me on the train back. I was dizzy with the experience, especially my mother saying, you must go. And she said, give me a ring when you come back. And I told her. I didn't tell her about the sex, obviously. And I said, it was all lovely. And she said, was it a nice garden? And I said, yes, it was roses all around, just like a cottage house. And all of that is important to me. And then he came up on the Wednesday and he took me out to dinner, and then driving me home, he asked me to marry him. He stopped the car and he said, I have something to ask you. I can't stop thinking about you, and it may be that I have to go to Germany at the end of the month. And he said, I don't want to lose you. I'm in love, and will you marry me? And I said, yes. I'd been out with him twice. One of the biggest bonuses, being able to ring my grieving mother that very night to say he has proposed. And she said, I hope you said yes. I said, yes, Mama, I said. And she said, oh, Moll, she said, I'm going to go and have a drink now. And she said, I can't afford champagne, but that's what it deserves. Can you come down at the weekend and we can drink champagne now? My daughter's got engaged. Now I'll have both daughters married, and this one, she said, will elevate you socially. That's what she said to me. I was pregnant by the end of the honeymoon. That's how fertile I was. So I'd been good to be careful before, you know, because I'd never been pregnant before. And we didn't remain in Germany. We came back to London because it wasn't a success. I wouldn't go to any of these cocktail parties with all what I thought was a bunch of middle-class cunts, quite frankly. You know, the general and his wife, you know, all of these invitations were coming. And the person who had employed Michael said, you know, you have been a deep disappointment socially. Your wife, you know, not to mix with the other wives and everything. I couldn't do it. I took to my bed. Anyway, we came back to London. I was heavily pregnant and I had this beautiful little baby. And I looked down at this beautiful, placid, lovely, blue-eyed, fair-haired child. I knew that it was, although it had come from my body, that it was another individual. Of course, I never applied myself to star signs then. And that child, I'm Aquarius, and this child was a Leo, king of the jungle, or in her case, queen of the jungle. A few years later, I had my second baby, and that was Sophie. And now, when I held Sophie, who's a Gemini, I did have a different feeling towards Sophie, because Sophie, the minute they gave her to me, I knew was an older soul than myself. Sophia means wisdom, of course. I recognized a wisdom. Where I'd recognized an independence and strength in the first child, I recognized a wisdom in the second child. We were amongst people our own age who also were pursuing very interesting careers. And so they used to convene in my house because I was good at getting the kettle on, and, you know, and Mike was good at getting the wine out. And we had the two small children, and it just was too idyllic to last. His infidelity came to light. And I was absolutely devastated. Subsequently, that wasn't the only one. There were many, many. He was a very, and remains, a very attractive man, very attractive to women, because he has got, and I always think that a voice is very important. Look at the success of Burton or Orson Welles, you know, after all, did capture Rita Hayworth, didn't he? You know what I mean? There is something about a voice which can talk a woman into bed. And he has got the same sense of humour as me. And when we meet now in grandchildren's gatherings, I see absolutely why I fell for him. When he says goodbye, he always says to me, you know, je t'adore, Moll. It's very sweet. I didn't think that it would ever come to that pass, because I was very embittered about these infidelities for a long, 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 long time. But I have to look at my part in all of that, because it might have been difficult to live with somebody with an obsession for painting as I had. I went up to my studio to get on with all the commissions, huge canvases bare and waiting. I stood there, just simply, I'd lost the eye. I could have stuck the brush in paint and just stood there. I didn't know how to do it. I'd been so traumatized. I kicked him out on the Sunday, Michael, and I said, I'll be at the solicitor tomorrow. I'm having a divorce. I mean, I do have a sense, a moral sense around matrimony. I do think that if you're going to commit yourself to a person in matrimony, that it does mean to me fidelity. It has to be total fidelity. I sought solace in alcohol and sex. I had a wonderful time, really, between marriages, because then I had my three constant lovers for 5 years. I wouldn't have any of those three lovers leave who the people that they were with, because I didn't want one of them. Three was just about the right number, because what each one didn't have in the way of a character or a physical attribute, the other one did. It needed three. I do really have a great belief in multiple relationships. I must say that. And then I had a telephone call from Mary Holland saying, they want you to, you know, become fashion editor for Nova. Oh no, I wouldn't like to be fashion editor. Moll, she said that, and she mentioned how much I'd probably earn. And the picture changed just like that. It just changed. I thought I could never be bought. I've always said I've never done stuff for money. And I went to Nova, they offered me all this stuff, and I did the job. And I became, well, I won every fashion award that there was. We won first prize, all my pages and everything, all stuff that I just tossed off. I was a renegade there. I didn't believe in it. I hated doing the couture fashion with all of these right-wing, you know, bitches from American Harper's, and those were the worst, and I was sitting them exactly with them later on, though not on Nova. But I discovered Paco Rabanne. I put all clothes by Paco Rabanne instead of doing all the couture, you know, all plastic clothing, because he was an avant-garde architect. And I stayed a whole 10 years in fashion. I went to Nova, I won all those prizes. I was sacked for being avant-garde. You know, I was full of myself by that time. I went to Harper's, horrible, horrible, very right-wing. I got the sack from there, I engineered the sack from there, and then I went to the Sunday Times. I started at the Sunday Times, I was about to go there, but I met then what was to be my second husband. His name was Patrick Hughes. He was a lecturer for the summer school in Barry, where I was learning photography. And we went to bed immediately. And it was the same as with Michael. The sex was absolutely in the right place. The skin slid upon each other and it was pretty sensational. He asked me to marry him the second time we went out and I said yes, though he was married at the time. He moved in immediately and when his divorce came through, we got married right away. He said when he came to live with me, I will not have your paintings in the house with me. I said, I've finished with painting. I'm never going to paint ever again. You can do what you like with them. And so I came back from the Sunday Times and the girls had returned from school earlier and were ringing around to all my friends, say, Patrick is putting all Mum's paintings out for the dustman to collect. I had regular letters from Harry Evans complimenting me on my pages, my fashion pages. I started winning more awards there, Fashion Editor of the Year and all of that. And it was Fashion Editor of the Year when I got the sack from there, because for being, you know, well, answering back and saying, we're not doing this ordinary stuff, that is what I'm doing and that's how it's got to be. And he said, well, you know the alternative. Yeah, I said, I'll take the sack. Okay, I'll go. But this time I said, I'd like to have money to go. And I got money to go from the Sunday Times. So on the strength of that, we sold our house in London and we moved down to St. Ives. We had an amazing time in St. Ives because I'd started writing novels. I'd written one when I got the sack from the Sunday Times. That kept me for a year whilst I wrote my first novel. Patrick, at the end of the day, I imposed 1,000 words a day upon myself to do, because I'd learned to write on the Sunday Times by this time, and I made myself write 1,000 words a day. I found this amazing skill with writing, and then he'd come back and he would read it afterwards. He would say, you'd read the 1,000, he said, you've done the 1,000? And I say, yeah. And he'd read it, I was writing comic erotica, my chosen field. So he said, incipient erection, good laugh, bottom of the page, first page. Second page, he said, well, yes, hardening erection, and very hard by the bottom of the page, no laughs. Third page, lots of laughs, laughing all the way through, reduced erection. Watch that, Moll. I wrote 10 novels in 10 years, one novel a year, which any novelist or any publisher should say is a hell of a lot of novels to write. And at the same time, I did a lot of journalism, a lot of television. I became known so that we couldn't move on the beach in St. Ives or anywhere. Everybody recognized me. But it didn't matter. I had a sex diary in Forum. Young husband and myself, I used all my sexual exploits. And then we went to New York when the kids started leaving home and all of that. Went to New York and we set up home for a year. We lived in the bastion of bohemian depravity, the Chelsea Hotel. I thought I'd love it there, and within a week I knew that I couldn't live happily in New York. A person was dying outside on the sidewalk. Nobody stopped, and Patrick said, that's your fucking Welsh Chapel Puritanism coming in again, Molly. He said, it'll spoil your life for me. Anyway, we stayed there a year, and within a week of our return, which had been a hectic year where we dabbled in a bit of cocaine and never went to heroin, but cocaine, I was mad as a cracker on that. I didn't sleep for a week. I couldn't. I was too high already. I had a bit of dope smoking, which also sent me. He said, you're going to be in the psychiatric ward with your mum. You can't do any of these things. And when we got back, we stayed at the Chelsea Arts Club, and within a week, the marriage was over. It had just spent itself. Patrick had a lovely phrase for it. He said, when he described it to people, Moll and I have attended the same magnificent feast, and then the feast came to an end by the end. And that is really, when I look back now, how it was. Both those men introduced me in their different ways to different writings, to an intellectual avenues that I wouldn't have explored without them. And there was a real connection, sexual connection, physical connection there. And there also was a great deal of respect. I was very respected by those men, and I respected them. At the same time, there was always, when we'd been drinking, I drank as much as them, possibly even more. Well, anyway, but it had an effect on me because I was smaller, you know, with less for it to travel around. And violence occurred then, extreme violence. And I'd had broken noses, bashed eyes, broken teeth a lot, and then sensational sex after it. That was my father's pattern with me, so I understood it. Both of my husbands, well, both were drunk when I met them. The second one was drunk as well. And all my lovers were, they drank alcoholically, and I loved it. I wouldn't have been with them otherwise. I wouldn't have been with anybody who didn't offer me a good time through alcohol. Both my parents were alcoholic. One grandfather was alcoholic. On my grandmother's maternal grandfather's side, alcoholism and gambling raged through the generations, to the loss of properties, castles, the whole lot. But I didn't have that in mind when I had my first large gin and Dubonnet. I'd seen the film Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and I can only assume that liquid that he was taking to effect the change in him must have had quotients of alcohol in it. And I loved the effect of it. All my inhibitions just disappeared, toppled with the first sip, I should say. I usually was in a dancing place. I was on the dance floor in moments, and people were queuing to dance with me. It seemed that I was a pretty infectious person in alcohol, and so it was to continue for the next 25 years. My first husband was drunk when I met him. I was drunk when I met him. Well, he sorted that. I'd arrived at the party sober, then in moments, seemed to me, I was this jolly girl. What I liked about it, alcohol, is that it did melt this awful pain inside. It wasn't like toothache, but it was like a non-specific ache that I had, which I think was about my father and me, an awful knot of guilt and confusion. That went when I'd had a drink. Anyway, when I got married, I mean, I finished with James when my father died. My life went in a different direction, but the drinking didn't go in a different direction. It was my best friend. Alcohol was my best friend. I liked knowing it was in the world. And being such a hard worker, I was playing hard, but I was equally working hard. I was very popular. I've always been very popular. I think it's the capacity to take the piss out of yourself and make people laugh. I really think that's what it is. And I do have a genuine love for my fellow humans. That's from the chapel, of course. But because I was so popular, I threw with both husbands, who also were very popular, many, many parties. I would give a dinner party for something like 30 people, or we had big homes, we had big rooms in the house. I was very, very successful, financially speaking. The drink didn't get in the way with my work, and not until right at the end, which is what drew me into sobriety. But the effect on my children, my mother, of course, loved it because there was a steady supply. My sister and my brother-in-law and their children, when they came up, because there was so much life in that house, they loved it too, and they didn't live like that, of course. But my children were brought up in an alcoholic household. Both their father and I had alcohol in the house. Many houses, I understand now, households don't have alcohol in the house. In my 19 years of sobriety, it's amazed me how many people on this earth don't drink at all. It doesn't occur to them to have a drink. after I'd finished with both husbands, the drinking escalated because I went into journalism and I learnt how to drink in the middle of the day when everybody went to the pub to organise what we'd be doing on our page for Sunday. It's when I was on the Sunday Times. Well, I'm sorry, Sunday Times, but the people that I worked with were in the pub. We went to the pub. My second marriage finished, my drinking certainly escalated then because I was on the market again. I loved my time between marriages, and in fact, my time between marriages is still going on because I wouldn't get married again after that. And I've had plenty of offers after the last divorce. But my mother and I were drinking companions. We used to have wonderful times. The only time that I liked sitting around the fire was with my mother and a bottle or a couple of Glenfiddich of an evening, as we say. And we used to talk about wonderful things and laugh. She was a wonderful companion for me, my mother. We were simply absolutely on the same wavelength. And when I visited her in her psychiatric sojourns in the psychiatric hospitals, I didn't like leaving there at the end of my visits. I felt I belonged there. I loved all the people there. They seemed like kindred spirits, especially my mother, my most kindred spirit. When she died, within a year, I'd given up alcohol. I was released from it. There was seemed to me no reason anymore to drink. When I was in the gutter at 7 o'clock in the morning at the end of a week-long binge, I was in the gutter at Smithfields, and I'd been ejected, not forcibly, but kindly, as it was suggested in the pub, the meat porter's pub, that they open at 5 a.m, which is why I was there at 5 o'clock every morning with friends. But I was falling asleep in my gold lamé at 7 a.m, and the barman said, "Moll," he said, "best go home now." He said, "you've been out a week," and he said, "that would be the best." Well, I tried to get to the curb, I managed the curb, and then I was in the gutter. But I thought then, what a wonderful time I'm having. Like Oscar Wilde said, all of us are lying in the gutter, some of us are looking at the stars, something like that. And I looked up, there were no stars. It was a bright, sunshiny day. I didn't like the feeling of not being part of this earth or this planet anymore, because there were people with their briefcases and walking sticks and top hats, bowler hats. They dressed like that then. Well, it was 1987. They were going off to the city. And I thought, who are these people dressed nicely? Me and my gold lamé, a bit besmirched after a week, of course. And I had serviced those meat porters, I can't remember how many, in the ladies' lavatory only a few hours before. And they were all stepping over me and saying, "Moll, pull yourself together." Nobody gave me a helping hand, and no taxi would take me. I suppose they were worried that I'd be puking all over the cab. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, I went to bed, and at 2 o'clock, I must have slept 12 hours. And at 2 a.m, this little voice said, "You need to take your friend," I won't say his name, "to AA, he needs AA." Well, it wasn't my friend, it was me. And it said, "It's you, Moll." And I said to myself, "It's me." And I went to the self-help group, that's what I went to. And my sobriety started. Now, that was 19 years ago. Only last week I visited that gutter and that, I didn't go into the pub, but I blessed the gutter, because that gutter steered me into a totally new direction. And I'm now 19 years sober, and I haven't had a cigarette either, so a drink or a cigarette. And the promiscuity vanished like a puff of smoke. I've only had 3 lovers in the 19 years. I had one at Christmas a couple of months ago, the one in Las Vegas, 24-year-old. If there's anything that I regret about my drinking, it is how it would have affected my children, because if there's an alcoholic mother or father in the household, it does have its effect on the children. I've had to spend the last 19 years repairing the relationship which I had with both those daughters. I wanted to say to them, look, girls, I'm ever so sorry about the last 30, because it took 30 years. That's how long it took, about 25, 30 years. I'm ever so sorry about the last 30 years. Is that all right? You know, for being, I'm sure, unreliable and not there and simply drunk every evening over dinner or whatever it was, whether there were people there or not. And it doesn't work like that, because I had to look at myself. Was I ever late when I was meeting up with those children? Yes, I thought, well, it's only the girls. I had to look at the punctuality. I had to look at the fact that when my little grandchildren, the four grandchildren who will have never seen me drunk, touch wood and whistle, never will, I gave up alcohol as well, because I didn't want to be like my mother. She dropped my oldest child, mercifully not on the head, but she had to insist on having her on the couch, and then she just got up and the child fell. She was, you know, a few months old. So I didn't want to be like that. When you make amends to people, love is not just a noun, it's a verb as well. You have to be loving, you have to be non-judgmental. I've practiced all of these things. Both these girls now, Sarah and Sophie, I do have a very beautiful relationship with them. More special, I think, I don't know if they'd agree, than if I'd never had this history of the alcohol, because I'm just a much more compassionate, kinder, wiser, nicer person. I wasn't nice in alcohol. There was a side which would come up, which was cruel and spiteful, verbally cruel. What more can I say to it? There is life after alcohol. There is life after addiction. And that is what I feel about it.